Special thanks to Amazon for helping sponsor our trip to E3 2016. The Amazon App Store is part of the E3 digital ticket from Humble Bundle and Twitch this year. Hey, what you want? Amazon App Store is offering $5 in Amazon coins for some of your favorite mobile games. Check out the link in the description below for more details.
Welcome to Santa Monica Island in the rebuilt California Keys. Tourists used to love this place until the good, the bad, and the straight up ugly arrived.
What's going on, guys? James Blunt here with MMOS.com, and we are at E3 2016, and we are in the awesome-looking Lawbreakers booth. We just got to play a couple matches here, and they've got some really cool stuff to introduce to us, but let me go ahead and introduce the lead designer here.
How are you guys doing? My name's Dan Nani. I'm the lead designer on Lawbreakers.
Excellent, excellent. So you introduced a new game mode here we just saw not too long ago. Tell us a little bit about that.
Sure. So the game mode is called Turf War, and what we did is we started out with a base of domination. We want to start out with a game mode that you understood and learned how to play, and we want to twist it up, and that's what we do on our Lawbreakers game, is we take something that you're familiar with and we turn it around and kind of twist it and give you our take on it. And basically Turf War is a round-based domination style game mode in which you're capturing points and progressing towards a total number of captures.
Awesome, and it's super, super fast play. It's just like a really, 6 to 8 minute almost domination. You're trying to get on the capture points. Once you've captured a point, that point gets locked.
Yes.
Correct? And then it comes down to fighting over the middle point.
Yeah, a lot of the times it comes down to fighting the middle point, which is kind of fun because of the zero G that happens in the center of the map. There's a lot of vertical combat that happens. If a team's smart, they might be able to lock it down first, but then the question is, you have to go into the enemy's base and try to take theirs, which is a little harder to do sometimes. But every round is capturing 3 points. The team that captures the most obviously has the advantage, but there are several rounds to go through, and the first team to hit 13 wins.
Awesome. Now explain a little bit, we haven't really focused too much on the game itself.
Yeah.
So we've got two different factions here. We've got the Law and the Breakers. And now what really distinguishes the difference between them? And are they almost like mirror images of each other in terms of the classes available?
Yeah, so gameplay is a mirror image. We want to make sure that the competitive nature of the game still stays competitive. We don't want you feeling like you got match made to the wrong team and you can't play the favorite class that you really like to play. So we made sure that the roles on both sides are identical, but the characters and the characterization is different, and the fiction behind it is different. Obviously, the Law is fighting to uphold justice and to protect the peace, while the Breakers are more about breaking the laws, obviously, and also, it's more anarchistic at that point.
And in terms of lore, just to kind of, what's going on here? We've got something going on with gravity,
yeah.
And the Breakers are just out to break the Law. I mean, I don't think they're just there to pick on the Law,
yeah.
But so what's their kind of their story?
Okay, let's start back at the big event. The big event is what we call the Shattering, and that in game terms happened almost 50 years ago, and at this point the moon exploded after the governments that were united started testing on the moon, tried to colonize the moon, and something went wrong and exploded, messed up gravity, messed up the world. Fast forward to almost 50 years in the future, and they're almost in another golden age. They learned how to rebuild. They used the technologies that were discovered after the Shattering occurred, which allowed them to rebuild faster and more unique ways to manipulate gravity. But by doing so, they had to offload a lot of natural resources, sell plots of land that were owned by the government, and it allowed a unsavory, villainous type of structure to kind of emerge in our game. And at this point, they finally have rebuilt, and they didn't realize what they've caused in the wake of the absence of the government. A lot of illegal activity had occurred, and now they have too strong of a foothold, and now they're fighting up against something that doesn't want to be pushed back out.
And that's interesting. You said the moon exploded, so you'd think that the Earth would look like almost a dystopian, kind of rustic-looking,
yeah.
Typical post-apocalyptic sort of format. But what have you done with the artwork? I mean, we saw some almost iconic or familiar places here in the map we played.
Well, we wanted to make sure that there definitely was the apocalypse, perhaps, if you want to consider it that way. You know, if you consider the first 10 to 20 years after a major event like that were to occur, the world was scrambling to figure out what to do with it. How do I actually come back from this? And it wasn't because it was because of the technology itself that was discovered through them scrambling that they realized that they could rebuild much faster. Fast forward another 20 to 30 years, and they took advantage of that. And that's what the world is right now. So you're looking at the promenade. You're looking at what our envisionment of California is after it turned into a series of keys, little islands. It's no longer a solid landmass anymore because it got flooded, it got boiled, it got shattered, lots of earthquakes occurred, and they rebuilt on landmasses that were smaller. And so we still have the promenade, but the promenade has been rebuilt. It's a different type of a Ferris wheel. It's an island rather than connected to mainland. And we wanted to make sure that it felt familiar, but yet again, our twist, making it feel and look different.
Very cool, very cool. And I've got to say, one of the concerns, not necessarily the concerns I had, but was wondering how it was going to happen, was movement-based abilities in the zero-G environments. Being able to look around and kind of float towards your destination and stuff like that, it actually felt really natural.
Yeah, it took us a while to kind of figure that out. In the beginning, it was, you know, what's zero-G? Well, obviously, zero-G, if I jump in a direction, I'm going to keep moving in that direction. But that isn't necessarily fun or easy to control, and it was very frustrating when you just keep on, like, sailing past the location you were looking to get to. You're like, oh, I missed my jump, and I'm going to take 5 minutes to get back.
That's exactly what I was expecting, and, you know, that didn't happen.
It didn't happen. We actually, it's technically, if you're looking at it from the functionality standpoint, wherever you look is where you go. If you want to go up, you'll go up. If you go down, you go down. We just started adding inertia and a little bit of slowdown speed to force you to hesitate before you get to that point, so you don't have maximum control there, unless you have the character that allows you to have maximal control. If you're playing our role, which is a Vanguard who can fly, man, she can take full advantage of that vertical space, even more so than our assassins, who are generally more mobile, because in zero-G, it's all about where you want to go at any given time. Vanguards just aim and fly.
Yep, absolutely. The tether and the assassins are really cool. Being able to like just throw that out and whip around the different areas without having to worry about a cooldown on that particular ability is really neat. Another thing that was what I found interesting is that you have that cool mechanic where you can literally shoot behind you.
Yeah.
What made you think of that?
Oh, that's Cliff. Cliff just said, what happens if I can shoot behind me? And we're like, I don't know. What happens if you shoot behind you? And so he bound it to control, and now you can shoot behind you. We realized it's like, oh, yeah, you could shoot behind, but when are you actually going to do any damage, or how are you going to kill people? When it happens, it feels great.
Absolutely.
It doesn't happen often, but what we found out, which was a happy accident, was what happens when you shoot behind you and there's impulse? And we use that Newtonian physics that says, you know, I fire behind me, action, reaction, and I fly forward. And then it became a movement mechanic. And so in zero-G, you have a character like a Titan who's generally very slow, taking a rocket launcher, firing it behind himself, and suddenly blasting himself across the center of the map. And it became a great way of adding a new style of movement into our game to ensure that all of our characters have a potential for speed, but it comes at risk. You gotta fire your ammo to do it. So you can cross the map really quickly with the Titan, but you might have to expend two rockets to do it, and you're gonna have to force a reload pretty soon. So you now have to start thinking, do I traverse, do I maintain my ammo resources, and it's about risk.
Yep, and you're talking about the Newtonian physics, a lot of those abilities, like the Vanguard with the push, you can use that to get away instead of just, you know, using it as it's made to be used.
Yep, so the Vanguard's like a skirmish-based class, and it's not always about hurting, although it hurts a lot, but it's about pushing assassins away. It's better, it's more powerful than a kick to push her away. Same time, you might have made a mistake, flew into a room, and suddenly there's a Titan. You blast him in the face and get out at the same time.
And is it the assassin that has the disabling like blast, or there's a grenade or something
that
disables?
That's the enforcer.
The enforcer has that
EMP grenade, which
keeps
lasts for a few seconds.
Abilities.
Exactly, and it locks down the abilities, which is a great way of locking down a hallway. They can walk through it if they'd like to, but now you know at least they're walking through without their ability to use any of their abilities.
Awesome. Well, I've got one more question for you. It's, typically, we cover the free-to-play gaming industry, and I noticed that you guys started out as a free-to-play title.
Yeah.
Just give us a little rundown on what changed the mind on that and what you are planning on doing.
Yeah, so we decided to move away from free-to-play because it was we didn't want to introduce mechanics that unlocked gameplay over time. We wanted to give the players the gameplay from the beginning, and looking at how to take advantage of free-to-play mechanics always treaded on the toes of skill-based fairness, and we didn't want to play around with fair play when we were trying to make a very skill-based competitive shooter. And that was one of our reasons. The other one was, when you look at a lot of the free-to-play games in general, it's very easy to create accounts, and we noticed that a lot of our players don't enjoy hackers just easily being able to get back in. And so we didn't find a solution real quickly, and that was the decision for us to go for paid to play, to ensure that we give you all the content without having to pay for it, without having advantage or disadvantage, and at the same time making the barrier of entry for a hacker to jump in and just create another free account to hack the game again was a little harder as well.
That makes sense. Security is always important.
Exactly.
All right, well, thank you so much. The game looks absolutely fun. I heard that there is a free play weekend coming up. I guess, what, this weekend?
Well, Alpha actually opens up this weekend.
Awesome.
And you can go to our website, Lubbock thehackers.com and sign up for the alpha. Everybody gets a chance at it. If you don't get in this weekend, we have more weekends going to be opening up, and we'll be growing our alpha database slowly but surely.
Perfect. I'm looking forward to it. Yeah, thanks so for much. Your time.
Thank you.